I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out, wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. We're broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. I'm pleased to have guests representing the Minneapolis Health Department. Gretchen Musicant is the Minneapolis Commissioner of Health, and part of her team, Sasha Cotton, is the Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator. Sasha, Gretchen, thank you both for being here.
Thanks for having us. I have
been concerned, and I'm sure you are, about the question of trauma in our community. I felt anguish and personal, you know, just not fear, but I don't know the right word for it. But when I heard the reports about a 10-year-old child witnessing a shooting, an officer-involved shooting on Plymouth Avenue in North Minneapolis, the thought comes to my mind, what's the impact on this child's life? What's the impact when he goes to school the next day and he's going to be around other 10-year-olds or 12-year-olds? Is his life going to change? The question becomes, how does our community, what is the city's response to crises, to trauma like this? I don't know if he's been worked with by the city or not. I don't want to talk about personal business, but it's the idea of a child experiencing a traumatic event. How does a city figure in and help families resolve and get beyond things like that? Gretchen, what do you think?
Well, I think you're right to ask about the effect of trauma. There is a lot of new research coming out that in many ways just reinforces what we intuitively already feel and know about the cumulative effect of trauma. And I think there are layers of trauma. There's certainly a very acute kind of trauma that you just described, but there are other more subtle layers of trauma that accumulate and actually change the way a person who's gone through that reacts to the next trauma. If enough different traumas happen, it kind of changes the way your body runs through life. And so we do need to pay attention to trauma and think about how to dampen the impact of that. So there are individual ways, like counseling immediately. There's also sponsoring opportunities for people who've been impacted by an event to come together and to support each other. That's another really valuable and effective way to address trauma. And we are, Sasha, in fact, just came from a meeting looking at early childhood trauma where we're trying to pull together people from across the community to think about what does it mean to really integrate this understanding that is newly reinforced with science, but we've known for a long time. What does it mean for us to respond to that understanding? I don't know if you want to talk about where that group is going.
Sure, what are you finding?
Sure, I mean, it's a relatively new group that we've just been pulling together since the summer of this year, but really our goal is to look at and really educate parents and family and community members about the impact of trauma, particularly exposure to violence, for young children, because we know that it can create some really negative outcomes for them throughout their lives, and particularly for us, we're interested in adolescents. So a lot of research is indicating that kids who are exposed to violence like domestic violence or community violence will go on to perpetrate or be victims of crime much earlier in life and throughout the lifespan, which again is intuitive, right? It makes sense that if you grow up in an environment where violence is normal, that to you violence is normal throughout your lifetime until something makes you change. And so it's something that we want to look at as early as possible. And really that work starts with parents and families and trying to inform them of how negative those exposures can really be and how we can reframe conflict and not make it be violent.
So how are you finding you are able to impart that information, that knowledge to families and parents in a way that gives them a different strategy?
So what we're proposing to do in 2016, which will be the first real launch work of this group, is to do some targeted dialogues with young parents. Our work really goes from 0 to 24, and so it covers the gamut of both those youngest children as well as many of the people who are parenting them, who are often 18 to 24. So we're planning some guided dialogues with 18 to 24-year-old parents to really get some feedback from them about both their own childhood experiences with exposure and to also talk with them about what kind of support they would need in order to ensure that their children aren't exposed to any violence or to reduce that impact. And so we really want this to be a grassroots experience. We don't want to assume that we know the answers, because that's where we run into mistakes. And so we want to make sure that we're hearing from people who are most impacted and designing any work that we do based on that information.
So what would happen in the case of this child who witnessed the homicide on Plymouth Avenue? How does this process you're creating support this child or the family or other children who specifically see this kind of horrific, traumatizing activity? What do you think?
So I know that North Point and other providers are standing ready to respond to acute situations that are identified, and also the county as a whole and their therapists, I think, are available for individuals. We're trying to build some programs in addition to that resource. We have something called Inspiring Youth, and we're working with the Tubman Center. And young people who are in families where there has been some domestic violence can be referred for case management. So working directly with that young person, trying to get them to have a dampened impact from what they have witnessed and then move forward with their development. So it's young people who have witnessed violence, but it's also people who have been involved in maybe curfew truancy, or who are on probation, or have been in a diversion program, so that there is potentially chaos in their lives and trauma, and so trying to identify them and connect intentionally with them for quite a number of months to get them back on track. We are also in the process of finalizing some plans with the Hennepin County Medical Center so that if a young person is actually injured, not just a witness, but if they're actually injured, that in addition to patching up whatever wound that is physically and sending them out with stitches, that we also have someone who's knowledgeable about the community connected with them, empathizing, getting them the resources they need to, you know, lead a good life when they leave, and to cope with the trauma of having been injured. So those are a couple examples of programs.
You know, when you hear about the national disasters, I think as we speak today, there's a mass shooting incident in Riverside.
Yes.
I think it's Riverside, California, or mm-hmm. San Bernardino. It's unfolding now. Mm-hmm. And places like Columbine and other cities where there have been horrific incidences of violence that involve children, rightfully and appropriately, communities organized to bring grief and trauma counseling and make that available to those children, their families, the community, and there's sort of a public strategy because the healing has to be a public affair. Mm-hmm. My question is, does that exist for us in North Minneapolis or in Twin Cities? And so I'm still talking about the one kid. I'm just so hurt by this incident that I watched on television, but I know that this is not a sole incident. Mm-hmm. You know, it reminds me of what's going on with the outbreak in Chicago over the deal from last year, but also the 9-year-old kid that was murdered in Chicago, right? We also know that there are just too many of our young people killing our young people. That's happening in this neighborhood mm-hmm. and in our city. And so how do we organize a process and a system for engaging those children, those families, those communities that helps people understand grief, to grieve in a way that's productive and also that understands and, as you say, tries to dampen the impact of trauma associated with those events. Is there a plan? Is there a strategy at present?
So I would say that there's two answers to that question. Okay. An example that I'll give is that we did activate a similar outcome to what you're talking about, a trauma response, last week on the day of Jamar Clark's funeral. So we were able to mobilize trauma-informed professionals, mental health specialists, people who could work with those young people who might attend the service, and they were providing that at the Davis Center, which is right across the street from Shiloh. So it was readily available for young people who had gone to the service, and we also had those people kind of circling the block during the protests at 4th Precinct. So if there were young people that were there to participate in the protests but needed some counseling or needed someone to talk to, mm-hmm. those professionals were available. On top of that response, we also had our youth workers from the city, from the Youth Coordinating Board, out there to just engage with young people and make sure that between the 4th Precinct and the funeral site, that young people who were out and about by themselves had a familiar face. Our youth workers are actively engaged
Somebody
in the city.
To talk to.
Exactly. Yeah. So we want to make sure that both the mental health need is being met, but that also the social need is being met and that they're feeling a sense of comfort from a familiar face. We were also able to work with our law enforcement professionals to talk about the fact that if an arrest had to be made, that in the event that those were nonviolent arrests, could the consideration of our juvenile supervision center be the first thought, a non-secure place that young people could come and get some support and counseling until they were safe to be back out in the community. Exactly.
Take a
break,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So we do have the ability to mobilize a response like that. And I think that as we're developing those strategies, we're really looking at what kind of events will trigger that kind of a response and formalizing it more in 2016. But we certainly know that we are able to do it and that it is certainly a need in the city.
Mm-hmm. And it's important to me to have this conversation with you because I did not know, and I think our public doesn't know, that both the resource nor the plan exist. That's not broadly known, I don't think.
Yeah. And I think a component of the plan that Sasha just described is a bringing together of resources across the city. So involved in what she just told you is folks from the parks, the school district, the youth coordinating board. So it's not a singular responsibility, but the convening of it and the collecting of it mm-hmm. together so it works.
Mental health from Hennepin County. So there was a wide range of people who were willing to come together to provide that kind of a response mm-hmm. in a relatively short period of time right. that we were able to put it together.
But someone does need to convene that and make that knit together.
And I think it's important to note that we have a multi-jurisdictional team, mm-hmm. that most of those partners sit around that table, mm-hmm. and that group convenes on a very regular basis. Mm-hmm. And so those relationships exist, mm-hmm. even if a formalized plan isn't there, mm-hmm. for us to be able to pick up the phone and say, hey, we think there's a problem, we should probably do something.
And by that you mean the county, for example, the city, mm-hmm. neighborhood associations,
yes, exactly.
private and public institutions that
yes.
are stakeholders.
Yep.
Yeah, that's good, that's good. So, you know, give me a sense of what the range of mission of the Minneapolis Health Department is. Sort of how this fits into your
yes.
work.
Well, when I talk about what the health department does and I list all the things, it really leans to young people because Minneapolis is a young city. When we look at the demographics, we continue to be young. Even as the baby boomers age, the city demographics are young. And so we do focus on...
The young capital really is North Minneapolis, is that correct?
A lot of, yes.
North
Minneapolis is a very young part mm-hmm. of the city, mm-hmm. yes. And so focusing on are babies born healthy? Are women supported? Are families supported? Are new fathers supported in those very early years? What kind of a trajectory are little ones on in terms of getting ready for school, the next stage? And then another big focus on adolescents. So we have school-based clinics in the high schools. We have the youth violence prevention work. We're very attentive to sexually transmitted diseases and teen pregnancy. Even as I name some negative things around teens, like violence and teen pregnancy potentially, that work is done through the lens of positive youth development. We know that if young people achieve the things that young people need to do developmentally, everything will be good for them and for the community. And so we want to make sure that those opportunities to build a skill, be connected to a caring adult, have a sense of your contribution to the community, sometimes needs to be packaged differently for different young people, but that all young people need that. So beyond that, then we're also doing a lot of work around healthy living, so gardening and communities and walkable communities and bikeable communities, all of which help make a place feel, you know, more less stressful and more supportive. And then we do the kinds of things that maybe you think health departments do. We inspect restaurants and we look at the environment and we help people get the lead out of their homes. We also do a lot of research and policy work because we think if you change the rules and the policies, the ways that we operate, it can have a sustainable impact. So,
what are some of the policy initiatives you've taken in the past several years?
Well, the ones that come to mind, we stood up and supported an effort by the City Council to rescind a law that made public spitting a crime, because we said there's no health reason to do that anymore. Maybe back when they thought about it in the 1800s and TB was everywhere, maybe it made sense. Doesn't make sense anymore, and it's being used inappropriately. We've also taken a lead from the young people in the community around tobacco, flavored tobacco, and they've really helped us see what's available in the community and how much even having products, flavored products available is another kind of marketing to them. And so starting in January, those products will only be available in tobacco-only stores, and that was really led by youth on the north side. Mm-hmm. So those are a couple examples. Mm-hmm.
I'm Al McFarlane. You're watching Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Gretchen Musicant, she's Minneapolis Commissioner of Health, and her colleague, her team partner, Sasha Cotton, who's the Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator. We're going to continue in a minute talking about the work of the Minneapolis Health Department. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Gretchen Musicant, she's Minneapolis Commissioner of Health, and her colleague, Sasha Cotton, Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator. Thank you guys for being here. This is important work. You all are doing a lot. One of the things, Sasha, that you are concerned about is capacity building, helping people who want and can make a difference, develop the resources and tools and ability. Tell me about that.
So we've launched a new pilot this year called Blueprint Approved Institute, and it's really focused on just what you said, building the capacity of some of our very smallest agencies who are doing great work on the ground with some of our most challenging young people to reach. We know that sometimes young people really need that connection in order to feel like they can make the changes that they need. And so we've identified some organizations who we could see were making those changes, but weren't traditional organizations, didn't have grant writers or how to develop research. And so what we've done is We've offered them a micro grant, and we're also paying them for their time, a stipend for their time, to get some core training over the course of 10 months focused on just those things.
How so much that is a micro grant?
The micro grant is for $3,000, and it's just to do one project, and then they're compensated for their time and attendance at the sessions as well. And so, but really, I mean, they're getting such a wealth of knowledge from the actual trainings, learning how to develop things like logic models and how to really write a solid grant so that when they leave the program, they'll be better equipped to go out and get the funding that they need to take their programs to the next level.
So what kinds of programs are you experiencing so far? Who did you have in mind when you developed the program? And what's been the experience so far? Anything that's stellar at this point?
I think so. So some of the programs are familiar probably to your base. We've got Change Equals Opportunity with Jamil Jackson, who runs the run and shoot basketball program at Farview Park. We've got Farome Brown, who's done lots of great work in the community for many, many years. The Neighborhood Hub is one of those organizations that we're working with. So there's a variety. The core of our group right now is Northside programs, and we're meeting at North Regional Library twice a month. And so I think that the programs that are a part of our organization with the Institute are agencies that are right on the cusp of being really blossoming, but that just really needed that ability to both connect with the city and sort of get the inside scoop and also get some polish and buff on what they have been doing to make it really where it needed to be at for that next level.
You work with the park board. We mentioned the pop-up parks. What does that mean?
So our pop-up parks were in their second year this past year, and it's really a strategy to engage young people 12 to 16, but we take them in all shapes and sizes. So we've got sometimes little ones, and sometimes we've got older kids. But the ideal is to design parks in places that people might not expect. So sometimes there are park properties that are being underutilized. Sometimes we block off a street intersection and have it like a street fair. And sometimes they're actually at our vacant lots throughout the city that the city owns but are not being used because the properties don't have homes. And we bring a large trailer, and it's got a basketball court in it or hoop. It's got a video game system. It's got hula hoops and jump ropes and all kinds of fun things that young people would like to do, along with a staff of caring adults who are really committed to trying to build those relationships with young people. And they operate from 4 to 10, 5 nights a week during the summer months. So the idea.
Do one place for a week, or is it?
Nope, we move every day.
Every day.
Okay. We move every day. We do a high concentration in North Minneapolis because we identified that as a high need area, because we know that young people are really looking for things to do in this community. And so we wanted to make sure that we were providing at least another alternative and that we were providing them with those role models too.
Are you creating an expectation that you are not able to fully fulfill if you can't be there 5 days a week, or is success a problem?
I think that thus far we've been able to be there 5 days a week. We did actually pull back. Last year we were there for 6 days a week, and we had the capacity to do that this year, but we found that having them be slightly reduced increased the attendance. So not having it be something that was run of the mill, but that kids had to sort of wait for it to resurface, made it be more interesting. And so it's been very successful, and we're looking forward to continuing that as a core of our program.
And I think putting them in unlikely places also changes the perception of that space. Mm-hmm. So not only is there fun stuff to do and engaging adults to do them with and other young people, but it also changes your perception of this isn't just an abandoned place. This could be a fun place, and maybe it should be something other than it is.
And I think of it as a community respite. So I think sometimes we hear from community members that these small initiatives like pop-up parks are not the answer to the long-term problem. And I think as a city department, we know that. We know that that's not the long-term answer. But we do think about it as a short break for the community. If we can provide a safe space for young people and families to come out and enjoy an evening on a vacant lot and feel like they're at a carnival or a park for a short period of time, that's a break from maybe the stress of the way that their life is throughout the day.
How does that work with the perception abroad and sometimes within the community as well that young people are out of control? There's a sense that the 10, 12, 13-year-olds, 14-year-olds are in a dangerous space and that they are prone to, invited to, exhibit what's unacceptable behavior. And it's not that they will it, but the pressure of peers, right? Mm-hmm. And maybe the pressure of the opportunity and maybe the lack of structured engagement. And I see this as one way to provide and deal with that, but is there a different perception of who these young people are than what's being projected? what's being projected from my point of view is fairly negative.
I would say that there is a difference between perception and reality. I would say that I've been a youth worker all of my adult life for the last 15 years, and that and I've worked across the country and locally most of my career here in Minneapolis and St. Paul. And most young people are really doing and want to do the right things. They want to go to school, they want to be successful, but a lot of the times it is those episodes of trauma or those missing pieces in their lives that cause them to behave in a way that we deem inappropriate. And so I think part of what we have to ask ourselves as adults when we see kids behaving in a way that we think is inappropriate, instead of asking what's wrong with that kid, but really thinking about what has happened to that child that would make them behave in a way like this, and how can I help or help them find the resources that they need to build themselves back up? Because it's much easier to help build up a child than it is to fix a broken man. And I know that that's a quote, and I'm going to remember who it was, but I can't think of it right now. But I think it is really important for us to invest in our young people. And that doesn't just mean dollars, but it really means time. And that as a community, we can't be afraid of our children, even though sometimes the unknown is a scary thing. And I think that that's a lot of what it comes down to. We don't understand our kids. We feel like they're from a different planet sometimes.
And is it that we understand our own physical, biological children, but the rest of the kids we don't understand? Is that part of the issue or not?
And we're also finding, and we have a program of parent education and support, that sometimes I don't think parents understand the influence that they still have when they have adolescents. We do a lot of informing about parenting young babies. And then we as a society kind of forget to help parents along the rest of the path. And so they get to be a parent of an adolescent. And we know that adolescents are pretty good communicators of, like, stand back, you know, I have this. Mm-hmm. But they don't fully mean that, you know, stand back and then, engage with me. So we do have a parent education and support program because we know how important parents are. And so we're really focusing on parents of kids who are in a bit of crisis or trouble, because that's an extra job for parents to manage through that. We find that a lot of the parents of kids who are, in a bit of a crisis are in a crisis themselves. And so there's a combination of talking to them about, you know, what are some good parenting practices, but also how can we help you stabilize your housing? Or, you know, how can we help you make your food budget work through the rest of the month? So it's a combination of supporting them in their basic regular, you know, survival skills, and then also how powerful they still are as parents and how to play that out.
I'm interested in the question of equity and the question of how consumers feel about their ability to both know about, command, and utilize resources. Is their sense of the resource pool one that requires them to feel less than? Or is there a process that says to a parent, it could be a young person or an older person, you know, that you're the owner of our community, of our society, you are a stakeholder. You are one of the bosses in our city, right? Mm-hmm. And so all of these resources belong to you as a resident. Is that an issue at all? Is that being communicated? Does it need to be talked about? Do people feel disconnected, disenfranchised, and pushed back?
So I'm going to say that we know that racial equity is something that is a constant body of work that we need to work on as a society. And so for me as a youth violence prevention coordinator, the Blueprint Approved Institute was one of those issues around equity that when I took the position, I immediately recognized. Because what we found when we looked at our grant proposals, when we were putting out a request for proposals, was that many of the organizations that we were able to fund by our current standard at that time were larger agencies, which are often run by a diverse pool of people, but not necessarily a group of people that reflect the community that they serve.
Meaning?
And meeting an African-American led organization. So most of the organizations that sit at the table for Blueprint Approved Institute are African-American led programs that service North Minneapolis. Okay. And they are programs that would not have traditionally been programs served or programs that would have been funded by the Minneapolis Health Department because they weren't able to write the kind of grant proposal that we would have normally funded. And so that's something that we really felt like it was important instead of kind of not being able to fund those applications, but knowing they were doing good work, to be able to increase their capacity to improve their applications and improve their skill sets so that they could apply for money both from Minneapolis, but also from federal and state funders as well. So that's one way that we're trying to address racial equity.
And I think in terms of who's driving the train, which I think is a very legitimate question, with the parenting program that I just described, there is a curriculum, positive parenting, I think it's called, that's been studied and approved and, you know, shown good results. And so that's what we wanted our contractor to use, using working with the families. What they discovered from the families, though, is like, okay, that might be interesting, but I got some other things to worry about here in terms of, you know, how am I going to pay my rent, or is there enough food for the family for the rest of the week? So we rethought the direction and listened to what the people that we're connecting with were saying and said, okay, we need a different approach. We can't just use this best practice and shove it down people's throats. You know, we need to come to the needs that are being identified, connect with those, and then let's talk about this other component. So
you got to hear their voice. You hear
yes,
them. You need to see
them. Yeah. As Sasha said, we realize we're on a journey. We have miles to go before we get to where we want to be, but we're trying to be aware and trying to learn from what we see and experience.
What's your thought about what I call the legacy institutions? I call the Urban League, for example, a legacy organization. Places like Phyllis Wheatley Community Center, Sabathany in South Minneapolis, and some of the Pillsbury United organizations. They have been around a long time. All of them are relatively large, multi-million dollar operations, and they provide services. They've experienced extreme challenges in the past several years, and the nature of the challenges, I see it as an observer, is that as they continue to identify needs and create responses to serve their customers, their community, they often are challenged and put in a competitive mode, and the competition is from outside the community and as often, or from time to time, they end up losing. So they shrink, and their capacity to provide this sort of fully and well-rounded set of services to engage families and communities is diminished. I think that may be changing. I think that voice, that call has been being heard, but I think for the past several years we've been on the track of ignoring and reducing the capacity of legacy institutions to serve the community under the guise that we can't say that they've done a good job, so we can't keep putting money there. But from where I stand, the argument should shift the other way. I can't say that City Council has done a good job, because you've presided over this misery in my neighborhood, North Minneapolis, for a generation or two. And the city has to say, take responsibility for its failure. The city has failed. Hasn't been the organizations and community. So what are you hearing about that?
Well, two thoughts come to mind. One is, as we have, over the past decade, planned for emergencies, like the tornado or the bridge collapse or influenza outbreak, we have tried to learn from what we think we observed down in New Orleans, and that is that people in a time of crisis turn to organizations that they have grown to trust, which are in many times those legacy organizations. And so we have created memorandums, formalized memorandums of understanding with Sabathony and the Urban League and other organizations out of the recognition that these are foundational organizations that people turn to. Mm-hmm. And so we want a formalized connection to be able to communicate back and forth, to also make sure that they are able to keep their doors open if there's a power failure or other things happen. And so it's one small way that we have tried to identify the importance of those organizations. The second thing I thought of is something that came up this morning. Minneapolis has a process called Results Minneapolis, where we pull together some data, convene people to talk about the data, inspire ourselves to take additional steps. So this morning there was a session around infant mortality and reading by grade three. And there were not only Minneapolis officials, but there were also community folks, some from some of the organizations that you mentioned. And one idea that came forward as part of that conversation that we're going to follow up on is contracts that these organizations have come with all these kind of bits and constraints and edges that at times make it impossible to do the holistic work that is really called for. And I think we heard that there were people from the county, people from the city, and so we're going to convene some of these larger organizations that have several contracts just to hear from them. What does it feel like when you try and piece together all this stuff that we've handed you to do? And what can we do to kind of clear away some of the craziness that we might have inadvertently created as part of our contract? So I'm very excited about that opportunity.
Mm-hmm. You know, you mentioned before we were on this segment, one of the things you do is promote Shop with a Cop. I think it's a wonderful idea. Tell me about that and what's the motive for it and what's been the experience so far?
Right, so we did launch our first year with Shop with a Cop that was really focused on young people who have been identified for having high risk for violence, perpetration, or victimization. So they may be young people who traditionally we wouldn't expect to want to spend an afternoon shopping with police officers.
And they're not children.
We went all the way up to age 24. Okay. So it was really about helping young people get prepared to either go back to school or college or for job readiness. Mm-hmm. So they could buy anything from basic hygiene products, mm-hmm. all the way up to like work boots, mm-hmm. for construction workers who are prepping for that kind of work. And the idea was to give young people and officers who may not normally have an opportunity to speak and spend time together a way to convene, so they had some food together, spent some time in some, not necessarily workshops, but some guided dialogues. And then they were paired up one-on-one and went out and spent about $100 a piece, mm-hmm. on supplies that they might need in their lives. They had, you know, a list of things that they wanted to get. We did two of those. We did one serving the north side that was downtown, and we did one in South Minneapolis at the Target location on Lake Street. And Target was a great partner to us. Mm-hmm. Our officers, I think, got an opportunity to see young people in a different way, mm-hmm. and the young people got an opportunity to see the officers in another way. So an example of that was we had a young lady who came with her program manager, and she was just kind of kicking and screaming about it. You know, she wanted the gift card, but she didn't want to shop with a cop. And mm-hmm. she put up all these walls. Oh, I want a woman cop. Oh, I want a black cop. You know, she had all these rules. And so by the time we finally matched her with, it was a female officer, but she was a white woman, and I don't want to work with her. She's not nice. By the end of it, they were calling each other by first names, and, you know, it was like they had developed a bond. And when I asked her about it, she said, oh, I didn't think she was going to be that nice, but she was really nice, and I really like her. I would call her if I needed something. And so just those short periods of interaction can sometimes really personalize the relationship and make someone feel comfortable. So we're trying to do that, as well as providing young people with some of the basic needs that they might need to feel good about going back to school or work.
I really like what you said earlier about the institute where you identify emerging businesses, because that sort of addresses the question I was raising too about equity, mm-hmm. and access. And so what's your vision there? Here's my vision. We have, our city is known by the disturbing disparities. Mm-hmm. While, you know, as I said earlier, you know, the state's so healthy and so employed, less than 4% unemployment in the city, but 18% or 15% here in North Minneapolis. Health disparities, you name all the categories that those disparities show up, education, income, wealth, access in general. In the area of health in particular, can we find a way to identify the problem as an opportunity? I had a discussion with Stella Whitney West And our conversation always ends up on this catchphrase, our health is our business. The proposition is that the world wants a cancer solution. We want the pill that'll prevent or cure cancer. The reality is that it takes thousands of people and thousands of hours of research and thousands and maybe millions, billions of dollars that the public and the private sector invest because we believe that an answer can be found. We create an economy around health. If our community is underemployed, if our community is undereducated, if our community has less access than it needs, if our community is less healthy than it can be, can we turn all of that into not a deficit, but an asset, an opportunity that can create a pathway to full employment, create a pathway to 100% health? I mean, what if we had North Minneapolis as a blue zone? What if that was the vision of creating enough engagement, involvement, equity, access, opportunity, business, being a part of the revenue stream associated with health and wellness? What do you think about that?
Well, we know with some certainty that a huge percentage of what determines health has nothing to do with health services. Right. And it has to do with the community. It has to do with the assets that are there. It has to do with the opportunities that people in the community have. And so we in the health department have that high in our mind as we design things. Our healthy living work, we have, which is physical activity and healthy eating and exposure to tobacco, we have intentionally invested in building assets in under-invested communities like North Minneapolis. For example, we helped launch the bike shop on Glenwood because there was no place to buy a bike in North Minneapolis or to get a bike part, and it was also an employment opportunity for young people to work there but also learn a skill and work elsewhere. And I think other healthy living work around the food environment, urban agriculture, the processing of food, the selling of cooked food. You know, it's a whole enterprise opportunity and it enhances health. So I think these combinations of strategies that build jobs, create a more vibrant community, and improve health is what we're trying to strive for. I like your idea of a blue zone. I think there's probably opportunity to think about how could we meld even more of our strategies together to create something like that.
I'm Al McFarlane. You're listening to, watching Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Gretchen Musicant, who is Minneapolis Commissioner of Health, and her colleague, Sasha Cotton, who's the Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator. We'll continue in a minute. Come back.
Oh, pirates, yes, they're robber. So lie to the merchant ships. Moments after they come, it took her from the bottomless pits.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane, a rich conversation with Gretchen Musicant. She's Minneapolis Commissioner of Health, and with Sasha Cotton, who's Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator. I ask my guests all the time about their passion and their personal story, how they got to where they are so vested and so committed to the work that they do. I'm going to start with you, Sasha. One thing you told me earlier, that you're three generations,
that's right.
St. Paul. Tell me about your family.
Yeah, my family has been in Minnesota since the late 30s. So I'm a very proud Minnesotan, very proud of my Rondo heritage and the fact that, you know, we were a part of such a legacy community. And so strong ties to the Twin Cities. As most residents know, I think St. Paul and Minneapolis, especially the black community, have a love-hate relationship, but we're just distant cousins. So not even distant cousins, maybe second cousins. So I have a passion for what happens with our young people in Minneapolis. As the parent of a 17-year-old African-American boy, I think I'm personally committed to seeing the world be different for him. And I think that there are some things that we've gotten right, and there are some things that we definitely need to do differently. So when I think about the issue of violence, as a health issue, I look at my son's life and I know that he has his basic needs met, that he has a really nurturing environment in his home, that he has lots of adults who really care and are invested in what's going on with him, mm-hmm. and that if we see a red flag, we're able to immediately try to address it. And I want for the young people of Minneapolis and St. Paul and across the country to be able to have those things and to really be able to experience what it's like to have a young adulthood and a teenage life that feels like they can focus on what they want and not the things that are going on around them. And violence is a preventable thing. We know that. We know that violence can be prevented. And so we are trying to implement those strategies that enhance the quality of life for young people in the community and that allow them to see a way forward without violence. So
tell me about your parents and your grandparents.
So my parents are both from St. Paul, are both Rondo babies. Mm-hmm. Grew up and were born on Rondo and moved to what's called Summit U.
You gotta say their names.
Eddie Cotton, Diane Cotton, yeah, okay, I gotta right. shout them out.
That's, so, right. That's right.
And my grandparents, my paternal grandparents are Eddie and are Nellie and Johnny Cotton. My grandfather was a legacy person at Jimmy Lee Rec Center, so he actually built a house across the street so he could be there to coach every day, mm-hmm. coached football most of his adult life, was a semi-pro baseball player. In the Negro League. So we've got, you know, really strong roots here. My grandmother on my mom's side has been here for a long time, has been a mother in her church, a gospel temple and resurrection temple for many, many years. So very, very deeply rooted in the community here and very proud of that. And I know that, you know, I've had opportunities to leave the Twin Cities and do work in other cities, but being here and having those connections has always been really important to me as an individual, but also for my son, for him to be the fourth generation of that legacy.
You and I have to also discuss, and maybe you do too as well, Gretchen, but I think you and I gravitate easily to the question of historical trauma.
Absolutely.
We have to weigh the meaning of why we're here. We have to be conscious of ourselves as byproducts of the transatlantic slave trade. Mm-hmm. And even though we have that as an origin, we also know that we have extensive and broad family and bloodlines, you know, mm-hmm. that we're not just one thing, we're many, many things, and all of that makes us really rich people. But how do you integrate this sense of awareness of the impact of historical trauma as a layer? We talked about layers of trauma, and then there's the challenge of specific acute trauma that you may experience in being in an environment, and I don't know what you describe the trauma associated with stuff you see on TV, mm-hmm. both as news and or as entertainment.
Yeah.
But all of these layers that affect our being and our sense of who we are and where we're going. So how do you integrate the question of historical trauma, first of all, in your work? So does it play a part? I don't know.
Of course, it has to, because we know that violence is linked to trauma and that our feelings about trauma and violence are, to some degree, in direct connection to our experience with slavery in this country as Black people. And so things like over-disciplining our children sometimes is a result of wanting to protect them during slavery. These kinds of things are not always outed in our community. We're not always forward in talking about them.
Explain that. That's a good question. It's a great observation, but talk about that a little bit, over-disciplining our children.
So I think that it's important for us to know that during slavery, getting out of line or misbehaving in a way that the owner would have responded to could have created some really bad circumstances for our children. Mm-hmm. And so as parents, sometimes it was better for us to discipline, or as we call it, getting a whooping, our kids. And sometimes that was excessive force because we were trying to protect them from what would have been an even worse consequence at the hand of the owner. And that's been a legacy. You know, you hear people talk all the time about, oh, Black kids, they keep their kids in line because they whoop them. You know, I mean, it's something that we've always said that in our community. And it really comes out of a system of trauma that we've leaned on, and now it's no longer necessary. It's something that was a necessity during slavery, but it's something that we've intertwined as a cultural practice that's actually doing us more harm than good now. And so it's about the things in our culture that are relevant and important to us now. We need to preserve those things because it's important to have them, given that so much of our culture was taken from us. But there are some things that we're holding on to that we need to let go of, and that's part of that historical trauma.
And so part of the learning the education is educating ourselves to recognize the difference.
Absolutely.
And to make different choices and to see how these things are connected to our daily experience today. Gretchen, does the same question affect you the same way that Sasha and I are having this conversation? I'm imagining it has to at some level or another because your experience, see, Musicant, let's see, I'm trying to think, that's probably...
Oh, it's an acquired name.
It's an acquired name,
so
okay.
It's Russian.
It's Russian, okay.
Yes,
okay.
But my heritage is Swedish and German.
Okay. Classic Minnesotan. Right?
Yes, okay. Yes. And yet, having been raised as most white people have been raised, mm-hmm. which is a little bit oblivious of your uniqueness, mm-hmm. There was an opportunity I had quite a number of years ago at the city. They had something called Culture Club 2.0. And people would come and eat lunch, and they'd listen to three speakers tell you about what it's like to be an American Indian, or three speakers talk about what it's like to be African American. And I would go, and I'd eat my lunch, and I'd learn. And one day, the organizer said, well, next month, it's going to be sweets. And I went up to her and I'm like, wow, who are you gonna have? And she goes, how about you? and I agreed, but it was one of the most difficult things I have done because I really have not had to be in touch with that lineage that I have. So I interviewed my mother and we talked about what part of me is because of that. I mean, other than my skin color, what part of that is because I'm Swedish? So. Yeah, there's other kinds of trauma. I guess the trauma being removed from just where did all this mm-hmm. of me come from. Mm-hmm. But I have been in the city as a resident my whole life. I was born here, went to high school here. My son also went to high school here. He's a third generation Minneapolis Public School graduate. Mm-hmm. So I'm deeply connected to the city. I am drawn to urban issues. Mm-hmm. I yearn for justice. I don't know why. I don't know where that comes from. Mm-hmm. Maybe because I'm Swedish. I don't know. I've had a few years when I lived in Italy as a very young child. I was fluent in Italian at the time, but clearly an outsider by appearance and by language. So I draw on that experience to understand what it means to be in a situation where people are pointing out your difference and your otherness. So I try and draw empathy from the few experiences I've had, but there is this calling to justice that is above and beyond that understanding.
And you said earlier you want to make sure that the sense of value and opportunity and maybe safety that you experienced as a child and as a resident mm-hmm. of Southwest Minneapolis ought to be available, accessible to every other resident of our
yeah.
city. Explain that.
Yeah, when I think of my life and the opportunities that I have, if you know, I want to be healthy and follow directions of what I should do, I can go running in the morning at 6 a.m. and it doesn't matter that it's dark out, and I can walk to my local co-op, and if I don't like the co-op, I can walk to a grocery store. And so I just think of the environment that allows me to be who I am in Southwest Minneapolis. And I think if I transplanted myself to another part of the city, I would not have the same range of opportunities to assert my healthy behavior. And so I want a city. I want to help build a city that feels like I feel in Southwest Minneapolis, the range of opportunities I have. I want everyone in the city to feel that way about their neighborhood and help build that neighborhood, those neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Let me end the program on talking about vision. You sort of started the vision. Violence prevention, what's the vision? What's the end game for you, Sasha? When you have achieved 100% of your goals, how will our community be? What will the difference be?
You know, I dream about a world where young people are really healthy and can really thrive. Mm-hmm. And when I say healthy, I mean mind, body, and spirit, right? That they feel secure, they feel nurtured, they feel loved, and that they feel ready for leadership. Because I think that that's also a really important part of feeling grounded in your neighborhood, that you feel that sense of ownership. And so to me, violence is just, it's one component of this issue of youth development. That I always say, if young people need stuff, And when they get the stuff that they need, they blossom, right? They need to be fertilized, they need to be watered. Mm-hmm. And so to me, when we can get to a place where all the young people in our community are getting that stuff that they need, I will definitely feel like our job is well done.
I had a conversation with Spike Moss this morning, and Spike was saying that he recently was at Henry High School for an event, but in the course of his being there, he identified people who said to him that they were gang members. Mm-hmm. And he talked to the leader of the school and told him that in this short period of time, I've identified 11 active gangs. Mm-hmm. And it's not that I could pick them out, but I'm talking, and they revealed their membership or their whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And so that scares me. It frightens me. I'm concerned about that. I'm concerned about it too, because the technology, the information, the range and capability for people that are upset to do damage to themselves and to others is exponentially greater than it had been before, I think. I'm concerned about it because I'm concerned about the one child who was the witness to the homicide on Plymouth Avenue. I think about children. I interviewed here one day General Riek Machar, who was the commander of the South Sudan People's Liberation Army. And he had led 20-year warfare in the bushes, and the warfare included conscription of child soldiers. And what he talked about in the interview was the difficulty, the challenge of getting these children who are trained to be fighters and killers to become civilians and peaceful again. What I see here, when Northside kids start calling themselves the Taliban, it adds a whole different level. When I was a kid in Kansas City, there was a street gang, nothing like there is today. This gang was some neighborhoods on that side of the street. They called themselves the tennis shoe pimps. And that's what they were, guys that wore tennis shoes. That was their deal. And the guys on the other block called themselves the Dragnets because they watched Joe Friday on the Dragnet movie. It was a big joke, right? And these were people that we knew. But the game is different. And so I'm concerned about that. So how do we figure out a way to intervene and engage and address? And you talked about families. Mm-hmm. A lot of times we're experiencing families that don't have that deep multi-generational understanding. And if the family has no training, doesn't see itself mm-hmm. or a role or an understanding of what parenting means, what can a child know? Mm-hmm. Anyway. I go on. We got about a minute left. What about it? What do we do?
So I would say we are trying to do some things to support parents. Mm-hmm. But I think part of what it is we have a very transient population in Minneapolis, many people who are from different places. So we really do need our community to step up to fill that void. We need community leaders like Spike Moss, and we need organizations that are well-equipped to fill that void that exists, because African-Americans are really used to having that extended family, and it doesn't have to be bloodlines that tie us, but we need our community to step up and really deal with our young people and engage with them.
Gretchen Musicant, Sasha Cotton, Gretchen, Minneapolis Commissioner of Health, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for your work. Sasha Cotton, Youth Violence Prevention Coordinator, thank you so much for this interview and for your work. Continued success.
Thank you for having us.
I'm Al McFarlane. Join us again next time. Thank you.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock.
gonna play your song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Cause this thing is safe. The message is clear.